Good morning. All right. I want to spend a moment to help reintroduce the mobile web. At Google, we love the web. The web is in Google's DNA. Google, as a company, grew up with the internet along with everyone else. We want the web to be first class because there's a lot of intrinsic values about the web that we really care about. The web offers a frictionless experience. You can just tap a link and you're there, experiencing what that link led to. You don't have to pause and think about, make decisions. Do you trust it? Do you want to install it? You can just move into new experiences effortlessly. The web is also discoverable. It's all just built on top of URLs. A single URL has a lot of power because it represents its content. But I can do quite a lot with it. I can store it so that I can revisit it again, of course. But more powerful, of course, is sharing. Links are shared by all sorts of means. And with those links, a single app or document can link into the state or another section of any other. And that link is just a single tap away from absolutely everyone. The web is everywhere. Interoperability is this beautiful thing that's let the web flourish because it's a shared, open platform with multiple implementations. That's the platform. That platform is on every device. And that single link can be accessed by everyone. And yet, you might have heard some less than favorable views on the mobile web. Not everyone is convinced. But respectfully, we disagree. It's had its rough times. And we may have missed the boat a few times. But I want to share what we've done about it. The mobile web is very much alive. The reality is today, the web is multi-device. And the count of users accessing it on devices is growing. And more than just increasing the number of users, the web itself is turning to be more mobile. In just 8 months, the number of sites that are mobile optimized has risen from 47% to 68 even. Things are improving fast, but the question is, why isn't this happening even faster? Why aren't all sites great on mobile? And what's holding back developers from delivering fantastic experiences on the web? So about a year ago, developers were asked what stops them from building with HTML5. And cited were items like performance, APIs, difficulty in building rich UIs, and immature frameworks. And we heard three key pain points come out of this: speed, integration, and polish. At Chrome, we take these challenges seriously. And we've been putting a deep investment into the mobile web and investments into addressing these specific pain points. So I want to share an update of what we've been doing in the past 6 months to make the web better. First thing that we can do is just make the platform faster. We want to improve the speed of the most common interaction, the tap. For a long time, there's been this 300 millisecond delay on all taps. The browser is waiting for a double tap to happen. We managed to remove this delay entirely, making a dramatic impact on the input latency that all users have. Since then, Firefox and Safari have done the same. Now we focused on other input latency actions, like flinging the page, and made good improvements there as well. The JavaScript engine inside of Chrome, V8, has long been a leader in performance. Its speed on mobile is a large focus for the team, and we're happy to report strong gains in our execution speed, reduction in GC latency, and a lower memory footprint on mobile devices. It's our goal to get the browser out of the way so that you can have full use of the main thread. This is a look at the same frame of animation. The second one is taken 6 months later. We've been making core improvements to the rendering engine, Blink, inside of Chrome. These improvements have spanned across the entire architecture, from the compositor to style engine to layout, paint. You can see on the we've moved this particular frame of animation from 18 milliseconds down to 10 milliseconds. Now, 8 milliseconds difference may not sound like a lot, but we've made this improvement so that all web content doesn't animate at a stuttery animation, but we can get 60 FPS. On the whole, we've improved the speed of animation 75% and scrolling 35%. All this faster than what we had in 2013. We're committed to helping you get 60 FPS on the mobile web. So speed was identified as a pain point, and we've delivered marked improvements in Chrome on mobile. Now that we're making the experience faster, we need to give you more control over the platform. So this means new APIs and features. One of the most fundamental features is Service Worker. You can think of it as a successor to App Cache, and it is, but it's more powerful than just that. It allows you to build offline-first experiences. Service Worker can manage resource fetching and caching on your behalf. And for users, it's a huge win, too, because they can get content faster, and they can finally have proper offline-first experiences delivered from the web. Service Worker also unlocks a number of high-value features. Push notifications is a great example. Time and again, we heard from you. You want proper push notifications on the web. So they're on the way, and they're being powered by Service Worker. Other capabilities like background sync, geofencing, are also coming, sitting on top of this powerful primitive. The web platform has long been monetized, right? E-commerce kind of changed the way that retail is done. But in the shift to mobile, things got a little bit more difficult. Keyboards vanished, so input is a bit more difficult, right? Request autocomplete is a new standard. I'm going to show quickly what this looks like. Just kidding. Request autocomplete allows you to build off of the HTML5 standard autocomplete attribute. And you can dramatically improve the process of filling out a checkout flow and other forms. We've seen a great improvement on mobile where a user can come through a checkout flow far faster than dealing with their thumbs on text fields all day. Now, WebGL, of course, offers great hardware-accelerated 3D content on the web. And I want to show this demo to you because it's really nice. I'm going to come over here to my phone. You can Google this yourself. Just look up Samsung Racer WebGL. I'm going to click into it. And this experience was just built with WebGL and also web audio. So it loads up. There we go. And we have a nice 60 FPS experience of WebGL here on my phone on the web. I can stop and then pan around too. The panning is done dynamically with the Web Audio API, so I really get into the experience. And you can see we're not missing frames. This is a full, slick 60 frames per second. All right. So, while the browser needs extra features so that you can deliver these great experiences, we also want to help users get closer to your content. So you saw in yesterday's keynote, the redesigned recents. So your web tabs move and merge along with recent apps. This allows you to move easily between contexts, whether it is web or app. So we heard you when you said you needed a more complete feature set, and we've been delivering on that. Now, no matter how web apps are built, appearances matter. The web deserves to look and feel gorgeous. In yesterday's keynote, you saw material design, a unified vision for visual, motion, and interaction design across different devices. Polymer has an implementation of this that you can use no matter what sort of device it is, laptop, tablet, or phone, whether your user is using a mouse, trackpad, or their finger. The web's got the same great looks. And we're bringing beauty back to the web with material design. I'm going to come over. We're going to take a look at one of the applications built with this powerful design promise. So this is an app, the quiz app, called Topeka. It's built with Polymer. So it's built with the next generation of the web. But beyond that, we've made sure to deliver a great experience. So I'm going to come down here, and as we move around, there's a lot of things happening. We have simultaneous animations and slick 60 FPS animation. I'll come back, and we'll go down to profile. And as I tap in on the input selection, we can see a nice effect coming off. We can see a similar effect, too, when we come into science and nature. And as I'm selecting, what is the only bird that can fly backwards? Albatross? Pelican? I'm not sure. What is the answer? Hummingbird, yes. The nice thing here is that we have a paper ripple effect coming off from the placement of where I put my finger. Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. All right. One last stop over in TV and movies. Select the actors who played James Bond. I know this one. That's good. Dalton, yes. Niven? All right. Yeah, that's good. I think that's it, right? But we have this nice checkbox effect coming in on the web. Oh. All right. Well, that was great. I'll come back to my slides. 0 points, all right. All right, we're excited to have strong UI components and UX paradigms for you to build experiences with. Now, we know that it implementing all the most awesomest features in the world doesn't matter if the platform is hard to write code for. So we've been investing in developer ergonomics and tooling to make it easier for you to build. Polymer is a framework for building the next generation of the web, and it builds on the power of web components. Now, we've been working on this for a few years, and the engineers who work on Polymer work in conjunction with those that work on the web platform. And this collaboration has worked out really well and has benefited everyone. It's great because the web platform gets to benefit from these great web developer-centric use cases. And meanwhile, we can make sure that the implementation of Polymer can stay on the fast path of performance. This here is a look at Polymer Designer. This is a drag-and-drop UI for constructing, you know, fast prototypes and other things. Not only can I drag-and-drop all these components together, but I can instantly dive into the code beneath them. Now, we care a lot about making sure that the ergonomics of building with Polymer is smooth. Using web components is just HTML. So take this Google Map element. Once I import it, I can use it very naturally just with attributes. Meanwhile, the element itself encapsulates and hides its implementation, so I can just reuse it easily. But as you're developing, you need tools to give you strong insight into the performance of your app and a great expectation of what it's going to look like to your mobile users. So we've been working hard to bring you a great mobile development and debugging experience with the Chrome developer tools, including rich device emulation features, powerful remote debugging, and rich instrumentation to understand how to improve performance. So whether you're working with Shadow DOM, ES6 promises, we want to make sure that the Chrome dev tools are behind you, helping you iterate quickly, and you can move fast, focus on delivering a great experience rather than focusing on the technology. Beyond the dev tools, there's two more sites that are critical in helping you deliver on the web. PageSpeed Insights will run your site against a battery of tests, helping you identify not only how to improve your page load time, but also UX concerns, like sizing your tap targets to be appropriate size, and also improving text readability on small screens. This is Web Page Test. It recently added great mobile device support, so which is an invaluable tool in helping you optimize for the critical path. So take something as fuzzy as slow page loading. Web Page Test helps you zero in on exactly what's holding you back. Here, we're looking at the film strip view. The film strip view is a great look at correlating the network waterfall along with the visual load of the page so you can identify what's blocking and how to make things faster. And so there's a lot going on in web development. We know that keeping up with all the best practices of web development is a full-time job. So, like, how do we address responsive design, responsive layout, images, navigation, hamburger menus, rich input, rich media? At Web Fundamentals, we've documented some of these answers into living guides. We're hopefully making the job of building for the modern web a little bit more sane. And taking the right first step is key. So we've shipped Web Starter Kit just last week. This is a boilerplate for building multi-device sites. It sets you on the right path with smart defaults. Some of the things inside Web Starter Kit, it has a complete set of styles and components and layouts, a style guide that's driven by components so you can help craft your visual identity with your designers, and tooling for build process and smart developer workflow ergonomics like device synchronization and live reload. So to recap, developers asked us for an even faster runtime, even better ergonomics and tools, and more beauty. We've had our heads down to make big strides, and we hope over these 2 days of I/O you've seen some of this. but we can't do it without you. The web is open. The web is a conversation, and it's a collaboration, and we need your help too. Actually, let me take a moment and tell you about a guy named Dominic. Dominic's just like a JavaScript developer, just like you and me. Dominic, a while ago, was taking a look at asynchronous, handling asynchronous operations. He ended up writing a blog post. This blog post, he was saying, there's a lot of people doing work inside JavaScript libraries, but he made the case for saying, the way that we're handling asynchronous events should be standard. We should be able to have all these JavaScript libraries interop with each other. This blog post begat a test suite. The test suite begat 30 compatible interoperable implementations, one of which ended up in the DOM spec. Soon enough, with Dominic's help, the promises has landed in ECMAScript, the language. So going from a blog post to landing a major feature that a number of web APIs are built on is a big feat. And not everyone is Dominic. I'm certainly not. So what can we do? First, we just want to hear from you. Anything that you can tell us on why it's difficult to build for mobile, what we can do for you, what features you need, what's slow, let us know. File bugs, be active on mailing lists. Just give us the feedback so that we can serve you well. Now, this also goes almost without saying, but build responsibly. It's our awesome opportunity to build these frictionless experiences on the web to all users, regardless of what screen they're looking at. The number one thing that you can do to make your site better for mobile users is just to make it faster. With DevTools, Polymer, and the other resources I've shared, you have a whole host of tools, not only to keep you on the fast path of performance, but to help diagnose and address when you fall off that. And for a lot of users, their first experience with your brand is your mobile website. So they'll tap on a link that was shared with them, maybe via Facebook or email to them, and they got it over IM, found on a pin board, or maybe they just tapped on a search result, but they arrived via the mobile web. Now that once they're in, they might eventually find their way to a natively installed app, and that's fine, but they came through the mobile web, and it's your responsibility to deliver success on that place. So this morning, I shared with you how we're making Chrome faster, from input latency to JavaScript, to massive improvements in the core rendering speed. We've looked at powerful capabilities like service worker, push notifications, request autocomplete, and integrated web and app recents. We're making the web beautiful and enjoyable touch, and we want to make sure that it's also a joy to build. So we've invested in Polymer, the dev tools, and other tools to keep you on the right path. We've done a lot of work, but we're just getting started. Chrome is committed to the mobile web. Chrome and Google are committed to improve the web for developers and for your users. We're not done yet, but you can get started today. Join us. Let's help deliver on the promise and the power of the mobile web. Thanks.